So this was an unexpected lesson. I had to throw an extra one in here as I was preparing for today. I wanted to do the rational root theorem. And then I was like, "Ay, ding dong." Once you learn what the rational root theorem is, you'll learn that sometimes fractions are the ones that we... rational root theorem is a trial and error process where we start guessing roots or zeros to try. And sometimes the guesses that we use are fractions. So I was like, well, I got to call an audible and take a day and go over this. So there's actually a lot going on today. It's a bigger lesson than I thought it was going to wind up being. So this might take a bit. Tomorrow I'm going to have to give you a work day because this assignment on the tail end can be a little bit, there's a lot going on here. So if we get time to it, to work on it today, that'd be great. And if we don't, sorry in advance for the long notes, but we got to learn how to use fractions. Before we can even get there, I realized we also have to learn how to do some quadratics of a certain flavor. So before we actually get to what the lesson is about, synthetic division with fractions, we have to practice solving some quadratics that are a little bit unique. So what you're used to with quadratics is if I give you a quadratic equation and say solve it, you go in and right now you currently would say either I'm going to use the quadratic formula or I'm going to factor it. Right? But there's another way to solve certain types of quadratics like this. Solving a quadratic does not necessarily mean, even if it's factorable, that you necessarily have to factor it. So there's something interesting about this particular quadratic equation, and it's that it's missing its B term. So for the next 5, 6, 7 minutes, we're going to be talking about quadratics, only quadratics that have a missing B term. In other words, B is going to equal zero. So these four examples, and I can do more if you want, they all are quadratic equations that do not have an X term. They have an X squared term, and then they skip the X, and then they go right to the number. So on an older version, maybe, or in the past with us, we would have maybe factored the left side down. I'm going to show you today that that's not necessarily what we're going to always want to do. So in a quadratic like this, mission number one is to get the x squared by itself. So if I wanted to do that, I would just add 4 to the other side, and I would get x squared equals 4. Now, a problem like this is actually pretty simple. We can just eyeball this. The trouble with this is when you ask people to solve this equation, and you can be the first batch to prove me wrong, but usually people say the wrong answer. So can you think of what X has to be? So you say X is 2. Let me ask you this. How many solutions should this equation have?
1. 2.
It should have 2 based on the fundamental theorem of algebra, which says that if the degree is 2, then we're expecting 2 answers. And if you tell me that the answer is just 2, then we're left wondering, well, how in the world could there be another solution? Well, there is. Do you know what it is?
Yeah.
It's also -2. Very good. So starting today, we need to start acknowledging that quadratics sometimes can be solved in a unique way. X doesn't equal 2. X equals positive or -2. And if you think about it, that actually makes perfect sense. I hope you're like thinking while you're note taking that that makes sense to me, because if I put -2 in and square it, I get 4. And if I put 2 in and square it, I get 4. So there, we just solved a quadratic equation, no factoring required, no quadratic formula required, just easy peasy. So let's take a look at another one. Same. All right, same logic. And I'm going to draw my purple egg again and just try to get you really get this stuck in your head. Mission one, get x squared by itself. So what do we need to do? Minus that 9, subtract that 9, move that 9, and we're going to say x squared now equals, -9. So we learned about this yesterday, and in the past, we would have said, wait, this is impossible. Like, I can't square anything and have it come out to be -9. I can if I know how to work with imaginary numbers, right? First off, what's the square root of 9? 3. But the answer to this problem is not x equals positive or -3, because as we know, that does not work. It is, however, positive -3i. When I'm square rooting, which I do hope you understand. Maybe I haven't explicitly said this yet, but you do understand when we follow that green arrow that we are just taking the square root of both sides. I'm guessing you probably inferred that from what we were doing. But when you square root a negative number, that's when you have to incorporate the I. Any questions so far? This is going to be a pretty common thing. Now, I'm going to make these a little bit more difficult. Now, I'm going to throw some fractions at you. So let's say we had 4x squared plus 10 equals 0. And again, as advertised, the B is missing, right? There is no B. So we know we have a new go-to strategy for quadratic formulas. No quadratic formula, no factoring. Let's just attack it. And the purple oval this time, I'm going to be very focused about this. I'm going to draw it very deliberately. It's going to go right there. So going all the way back to our basic algebra days, what would be the first thing we do to get purple oval by himself? It's too early for division. I would move the 10. Always move any extraneous terms first. Those terms that are kind of floating around, they should always be relocated before you go down division road. So we're going to leave 4x squared right where he is, and then we're going to put equals, and we're going to move the 10 to the other side like this. Now, I'm still on Operation Purple Egg, so now I'm ready to hear that D word. What are we going to do to both sides? Now we're going to divide both sides by 4. And when we divide both sides by 4, we wind up with a fraction, right? So we have x squared equals negative 10 fourths. So far, so good. Now you have a couple of options here. You could reduce, but in a case like this, after I show you how to do this, you'll understand why I didn't want to reduce. The logical question is, well, can I reduce negative 10 fourths down to negative 5 halves? You can, but you're opening up this problem to be a lot more difficult. Trust me on this one, which is weird. But what we're going to do now is, again, we're going to take the square root of both sides. And so if I square root on this side, I'm done. I get x equals. And you should always, before you even think about it, put your positive negative sign. Okay. Now, do you want to take a guess as to how we square root a fraction? I've never asked you to, probably before, but how do you think you could square root a fraction? How about this one? I'll just tell you this, that the square root of 16 over 9 is just 4/3. So how do we square root a fraction? You square root the top and you square root the bottom, right? So let's look at where this takes us. Now, if I square root the top of this, I'm taking up here on the top, I'm taking the square root of negative 10. And on the bottom, I'm taking the square root of 4. So on the top, we should know by now that 10 is a dead root. There's nothing I can do on the top. So on the top, I'm just going to have I roots of 10. And what are we going to have on the bottom? Done. Let that sit there for a second, sink in. Everybody got that? Square root the top, square root the bottom. If it's a negative somewhere in it, just put the negative on the top and then stick your I on the top and call it a day. Let's go again. Let's do 9x squared minus 3 equals 0. What do we do first?
+3.
Add that 3 to the other side. So we get 9x squared equals 3. Are we going to need an I this time? Correct. We are not, because we're not going to have a negative. We are, however, going to divide both sides by 3, and we're going to get x squared equals 3/9. And again, I've presented you with an opportunity to think maybe I should reduce that fraction, but you see why I don't want to. Why do I like the 9 on the bottom just like he is? Because it's square rootable. Don't look that gift horse in the mouth. I mean, say thank you, math gods, for the square rootable number. I'm going to leave it just like it is. So when I square root both sides of this, I get x equals positive negative. You should write that positive negative just out of habit. Before you do any math, just write the positive negative. What are we going to get on the top? There is no need for an I. Don't just think instinctively that we have to put an I. When do we use I? when the square root that you're taking is of a negative, and 3 is not a negative, so the top is just regular root 3, and what's the bottom? Done. Can't I just what? No, really, if it's a question, you should ask it out loud. You don't want to? Okay. How about this one? And there's a few more of these than I said, 4 or 5, but I'm already up to like 6. So my teachy spidey sense was telling me, let's hit a couple more before we press into the lesson. So first step. Move that 1. Good job. So we're going to have x squared equals negative 1. Are we going to need an I on this problem? Yes, because we're about to square root something that's a negative number. So if I square root the left side, I get x equals, and then I just write positive negative because I do that out of habit. And now I just have a question, like what is the square root of negative 1? What is the square root of negative 1? Now we're talking. You learned yesterday that I is quite literally equal to the square root of negative 1. And maybe you didn't write that down, but now would be a great time to write that down. That is the definition of what I is. And so if on the right-hand side, I find myself having to take the square root of negative 1, then the answer is just x equals positive or negative I. Done. And you could put 1i if it makes you feel good. But generally, we try to coach the unnecessary ones right out of you. Let's do one more. Make sure you're good, and then we'll press into what we're actually doing today. Let's do 16x squared plus 5 equals 0. And there's all sorts of flavors of these, but I just thought I'd get to the basic kind of nuts and bolts of how to do it here this morning. Step 1, subtract that 5. So you get 16x squared equals negative 5. Next step, divide by 16, and we find ourselves at the crossroads. This is exactly where we want to be, where we have x squared by itself equals negative 5/16. Always put the negative on top. We don't want to mess up our good bottom with having to put i's, because then we got to take the i's out. And so you got a choice when someone gives you a negative fraction. You're like, where should I put the negative? The answer is put it on top. So when I square root the top, this purple thing, what do I get?
I.
Perfectly spoken. So we get x equals positive or negative i root 5. Good job, Hugo. All over. Good. So that's the introduction for today. That's not worth a whole day, but that's 10 minutes of our time that I thought we should use to learn how to do this, because these little baby equations, as you'll see, are going to pop up as little final steps in these problems from now on. All right, so let's get to what was actually advertised, what we're doing today. So there's quite a few examples here. And at any point, if you get lost during the synthetic division, you do need to stop me and let me know. Staring at the board will not give you the assistance usually that you need. So our first problem is we have f of x equals 8x to the 4th plus 20x to the 3rd minus 2x squared plus 25x minus 15. And this time, the freebie that I'm going to give you is that f of 1/2 equals 0. So really, this is all I originally, when I was sitting there last night making my notes, this is all I wanted to get done. But then I realized at the end, that thing we just learned will pop up. So now we're ready when that happens. So now we have to cross the main bridge, and that is, how do I synthetically divide with fractions? It's not that hard. You just have to, I mean, if you're someone whose basic skills are dog water, has been saying this to you for years, you know, if you struggle with like 3/2 of 4, this is going to be harder for you than someone who gets it. So just reach out and let me know what I can do. But in the meantime, we're going to set this up like we always have. We're going to put our purple numbers, 8, 20, negative 2, 25, and negative 15. And then we're going to do our upside down division sign, leaving some space. And then the number that we're going to put outside is going to be 1/2. Watch out. Again, this is more of a cautionary watch out for those of you guys that struggle with basic numbers. So here we go. The algorithm does not change. Bless you. Drop the 8 and we're off. So when I say to multiply, what's really going to help you is to think of the word of. So when I multiply the green number and the white number, what's half of 8?
4.
There we go. First one down. Half times 8 equals 4. So the algorithm isn't changing. It's just the skills required to use it are a little bit more annoying, perhaps. What's 20 plus 4? And here we go again. Green number times white number. What's half of 24? Add those together. What's negative 2 plus 12? Good. Half of 10. 25 plus 5. Half of 30. 15. Negative 15 plus 15. As expected, 0. I didn't write the 0 in like early this time, but we knew it was coming. So far, so good. Okay, so that leaves us now in a predicament where we have to factor. And so thinking about these numbers at the bottom of the division sign, they are the coefficients of a new math problem. They are the coefficients of 8, x to the 1 less than 4, so 3, plus 24, and then just work your way down, x squared plus 10, work your way down, x plus 30, and we're going to set that equal to. What kind of factoring are we going to use for this bad boy? Yeah, GCF first. And then after that, what do you think it's going to be? It's going to be a grouping, isn't it? So first off, let's talk basics. What can you divide 8, 24, 10, and 30 all by?
2.
So let's go ahead and just do that real quick. Let's take the 2 and you can effectively throw this 2 away. For the purpose of what we're doing, finding zeros, that 2 will not yield any fruit. It won't produce anything, so you can throw it in the trash. Remember, if it has a variable, you can't throw it in the trash, but 2, dead, chuck it. So we can effectively just take this entire equation right here where I'm moving my pen and divide it by 2, giving us 4 x cubed plus 12 x squared plus 5 x plus 15. And now let's do our grouping. So I'm going to scroll up and we are ready to begin. So I'm going to draw my little dividey wall. And for the 84th time in the last 6 weeks, we're going to group. What comes out of the left side? 4x squared. And what does that leave behind? X plus 3. And then the next step? Bring down your plus first, mm-hmm. and then pull out a 5. And what's that leave? Nice. And then we're going to set this equal to 0. So as always, yellow makes a factor, white makes a factor. So our factors at this point in time are 4x squared plus 5 times x plus 3 equals 0. Right now, I can go in and I can grab a freebie. Can you see right now what a new answer is going to be? I have a freebie up here. Negative 3 is a freebie. This factor that I'm circling right now, that's a freebie. That one's just calling to you. For God's sake, take this gift I'm giving you. I'm telling you right now that you now have another answer to this problem. You can now add x equals negative 3 to your list. We already had a half from 5 minutes ago, but now we have negative 3, and we're looking for more. And where are they going to come from? The yellow guy. The yellow guy says, hey, I may not be what you want, but I'm not chopped liver here. Like, look at my exponent. I'm 4x squared. That means I have two answers to give you. Come and get them, sucker. And we're like, okay, now I know how to do this. I'm going to come and get them. So don't talk smack to me because I'm coming in. So I'm going to take this yellow factor right here, and I'm going to do what we learned how to do at the beginning of class today. I'm going to set u equal to 0. And this, you now see, is why we started class today the way we did. Solve that little yellow equation. What do we do first? Move that dang 5. Good job. So we get 4x squared equals negative 5. Are we going to need eyes or no eyes? We're going to need them. because we're about to square root a negative. We're almost there. What's the next step before we finish it off?
Divide by
4, which leads us to x squared equals negative 5/4. And now we're going to do the kill shot, the final move in the boss battle, right? We're going to take the square root of both sides, giving us x equals positive negative. What goes on top? I root 5 all over 2. And the process is complete. The only thing now that we have left to do is the annoying task of gathering up all the parts and pieces that we left behind. So our job now is to make a formal list of all 4 answers. We came into this expecting 4, and we now have them all. The first one I would write is the one that I was given at the beginning. Well, x equals 1/2. The next one is that easy one that we popped out about 1.5 minutes ago, x equals negative 3. And then the last one is x equals positive or negative I root 5 over 2. And that is what a list of answers will look like. All 4 answers are present and accounted for in that green box. So you just now learned and are in possession of 2 new skills: how to synthetically divide or substitute with fractions, and then how to solve those little baby chunk equations at the end require a new thing, a new skill. All right, let's go and do another one. How'd that feel? Nothing to it? Round 2, f of x equals 10 x to the 4th. I think that's a 10. Man, I hope that's a 10. Plus 17 x cubed plus 13 x to the 2 plus 17x plus 3. And the freebie this time is negative 3/2. So f of negative 3/2 equals 0. Every problem we do today will involve fractional synthetic substitution. Everyone. Tomorrow too. All right, so let's do the setup. Purple numbers first. We have 10, 17, 13, 17, 3. Upside down e division, and the outside number is negative 3/2. The trick to this is going back and remembering something that I taught you guys in Algebra 1. You may or may not remember this, but I taught you how to do the little fish hook. And the fish hook is handy when it works, and it's so handy for stuff like this. So I'm just going to remind you of, well, first let's just start the process. Let's drop the 10. And now right away I'm faced with a problem that for some of us will be harder than others. So I'm faced with having to do negative 3/2 times 10. If I write this out for you, negative 3/2 times 10. If you remember the fish hook, you'll see its usefulness here. Immediately you'll see the usefulness. When you want to do math like this quickly in your head, and you don't want to write this out every time, like ain't nobody got time for that, right? Give me a break. In your head, you just do the hook. What's 10 divided by 2? 5. What's 5 times negative 3? Done. Do the hook every single time and you'll save a ton of time. And by the way, as we get into Thursday's lesson and we start actually doing the rational root theorem and trying and failing, when the fish hook stops working, that's usually a good sign that you have something that's not going to be a 0. Just FYI. Not a guarantee, but it's usually a pretty good sign. So let's do the easy math. What's 17 minus 15? And here we go again. Fish hook it again. Take the whole number 2, divide it by the bottom 2. What's 2 divided by 2? 2 divided by 2 is 1. 1 times negative 3 is negative 3. And here we are. You're going to be real quick at rolling through this multiplication addition garbage. What's 13 minus 3? And here we go again. Let's fish hook it again. We just did this problem a couple minutes ago. Fish hook it. What's 10 divided by 5? 5 times negative 3, negative 15. Seeing a lot of repetition with this particular problem, huh? Could just kind of keep cycling itself through. 17 minus 15 is 2. Fish hook it, exact same outcome again. We get negative 3. Add those together, and as expected, we get 0. Easy peasy. So before we copy these four numbers down, why don't we just go ahead and do our due diligence and pull out the dumb GCF right away? You would agree that all four white numbers can be divided by 2. So let's just dispense with rewriting it over and over again, and let's just get right to it. This is 5x to the third plus x squared plus 5x plus 1 equals 0. Hope you didn't get lost just now, right? I just divided them all by 2. And of course, again, we're going to find ourselves having to do grouping. Grouping is a pretty common theme for the next couple of days. So we're going to draw our wall. What's the GCF of the left half? Yeah. What does that leave behind?
5x plus 1.
Beautiful. Next step, pull down your plus. And since you can't get anything out, you do have to acknowledge that I'm getting out a 1. Leaving behind. And then all of this equals 0. The yellow will make a factor. The white will make a factor. And if those collectively multiply to make 0, then at least one of them has to equal 0. We attack them one at a time. I would start by attacking the white one. What makes this white one equal 0? Absolutely gorgeous answer. Negative 1/5 is another one. We can add that to our list at the end. Good job there. And then, of course, the yellow one is what we did at the beginning of class today. So if I pop this yellow one out and I set it equal to 0, which is what I need to do, we possess this skill now. Move the 1 to the other side. You get x squared equals negative 1. And this one comes directly from our notes from 20 minutes ago. What does x equal? Careful. I'm going to be really hard on you about this. Yes, if you do not put the positive negative sign, I'm going to be really annoying about it. You need to, as soon as you get done writing the equal sign, write the positive negative before you do any math. Write it. That's where you get your 2 answers from. And then, yes, it's positive or negative I. And we can now make our collected gathered list of answers. What was the first one we got right out of the gate? Yeah, so you write it down. X equals negative 3/2. What was that second one that Kyla helped us get over there? Negative 1/5. We grabbed pretty late in the process. And then who are the late arrivals?
X.
Positive or negative I. Good. Feeling good so far? Okay, let's go again. Anyone having any issues? A lot of new math today. A lot of really good math today. F of x equals negative 3x to the power of 8. Oh my gosh. Plus 4x to the 7th. Whatever will I do? Plus 15x to the 6th. Minus 20x to the 5th. Minus 12x to the 4th. Plus 16x to the 3rd. I ran out of room. It's a whopper. And the freebie this time will be 4/3. Okay. Yes, there are going to be 8 answers. But the good news is that 3 of them are going to... You get 3 of them as a 0, so we knock it right down to 5. When you look at a problem like this, you should be very happy at least that there's an x to the 3rd that finishes the line. So that means that when we start this process, the very first thing we're going to do is we're going to pull out a GCF just right away before we even get started of negative, of course, and x to the 3rd. And if you pull that out, then right away, you just figured out that x equals 0 is an answer, and that occurs times 3. So that really chips away at the stone, makes our task a little bit more manageable. So now let's reconstruct the polynomial. This knocks everything down. What is the first term going to be? Nice. Next term? Fourth, because we're taking out 3, minus 15x to the plus, changing all the signs, x to the 2. Plus 12x to the 1 minus 16 with no x's. That's our dude. So just like before, when you get a GCF out, you're essentially just creating a brand new problem, right? So all this work that we just did is to create this problem. And it is now time for us to do the purple numbers and synthetically divide. So let's get to it. The purple numbers are 3, negative 4, negative 15, positive 20, positive 12. I don't know why I just wrote a positive sign there. I'm a man of principle. I got to erase that. 12 and negative 16, upside down division. And who's our freebie substitutor? Yeah, so let's stick that guy right out here. Boop. And begin the process. I could put a zero right down here, you know, not to like flex on the math gods, but hey, if you told me 4/3 is going to work, I'm taking you at your word and put a zero there. So here we go. drop your three and begin, and just keep using the fish hook, my friends. I'm telling you, man, it's your buddy. You shouldn't be like bogged down with this. What is the next answer going to be? Good job. 4. Add -4 + 4. What's 4/3 of 0? Yeah, a whole lot of 4/3 of nothing is still nothing, right? And then -15 + 0 is -15. Use the fish hook on this one. -20. 20 + -20. 4/3 of nothing is nothing. 12 + 0 is 12. Fish hook it again. 16, I heard you whisper. Very good. And there you are. So now we arrive at an interesting situation. Look at these zeros here, boom and boom. That means we got some missing terms. So remember that the original was a 5. So synthetically, we always by definition go down by 1. So that means that these numbers at the bottom right here are the coefficients of a polynomial whose degree is 4. So we're going to write out this polynomial. It is 3x to the 4th. -15x to the 2 + 12 = 0. Note these zeros, circle them in red for you. Those are important. That murders off a couple of terms, specifically the cubic and the linear terms. Go bye bye. What is this polynomial? We have a name for this little guy. What's that called? Yeah, it's a lookalike. So we know how to factor lookalikes, thank God. And so we're going to factor this down into 3x squared on this side and 1x squared on this side. And then we know some basics. What are the signs going to be? A minus and a minus. And now comes the part where you just kind of toy around with numbers that multiply to make 12. Anyone find the combo? Don't use 12 and 1. Won't work. Actually, no. Yes, it will work. Will it work?
Yeah. You put 12 there and 1 in the other.
What was I thinking of? Was I thinking, does this work? This is an amazing problem. Did we just find one that you can do two ways? If we put 12 here and 1 here, does this work too? That is so Brad, are we having like a moment? Wow, that's so cool. I can't wait to go later and look at this and see why it works both ways. There's a factor hidden in here that's making all this. There's a little factor goblin in there. Boy, I'm excited. I know what I'm doing at lunch today. Oh, I'm not skipping lunch. We're doing math, baby. Woo! Oh, I love that. So anyhow, yeah, anyone want to come join me? Come on in. Let's start with this guy. So if we have 3x squared minus 12 equals 0, step 1 is add the 12, and you get 3x squared equals 12. Step 2 is to divide by 3, and you get x squared equals 4. We going to need an I on this one? Nope. Nah, it's not a negative. So what are the answers that we get from this yellow one? Positive, negative,
2.
Very good. And now let's take a look at red guy over here. We could have factored further, by the way. I mean, like, FYI. But now that we got this dope new trick, then there's really no need to keep factoring these little square guys down. This is a cool little trick. So we got x squared minus 1 equals 0. Add the 1 to both sides. We get x squared equals 1. Take the square root of both sides. Do we need an I? No. So we just get x equals positive, negative, one. You go back now and trace our steps. And at the beginning, you're like, wait, are you telling me we're going to get eight answers? And the answer is, yep, we just got them all. So now we got to go back and keep track of all of our answers. And so I think if we make a list, we can start by saying, let's start with just x equals zero. And then we put our little times three next to him. Who was our freebie? So 4/3. Now we're up to four answers, and we're about to name the other four, because how many do we get from yellow? Two. So x equals positive or negative two. We're now up to six answers. And there's a list of eight answers just like that. You are powerful mathematicians. You just found all eight solutions or zeros to that answer. You good with just riding along with me for a few more minutes? And then I promise that I can leave the assignment on Canvas if you want to get started, or I can just take it off and you can take 23 hours off. But I do need you for like six more minutes. Are you down? Let's do it this way. Let's finish this, okay? Next one is f of x equals. This one is not quite as long as its predecessor. I wanted to give you one with a nice GCF just to show you how that works. And a lookalike. That was a lot of meat on that bone. 4x to the fourth minus 9x to the third plus 7x squared minus 36x minus 36. And the freebie, anyone want to guess the freebie? Yeah, it's negative 3/4. Why would you have guessed that? I don't know. All right, no GCF. Let's just get right in and purple number this bad boy. So the purple numbers are 4, negative 9, positive 7, negative 36, another negative 36, upside down division. And the freebie on the outside is negative 3/4. You feel in the flow? Synthetic division with fractions is not that hard. And like I said earlier, if you feel like you're getting into a place where you're like trying to do the fish hook with like a 17 and a 9 and a 2, that's a pretty good sign that you're something's not right. Like, so this should feel good as we go. Everything should just kind of keep working. Drop your 4 and here we go. What's the first one? Negative 3. What's negative 9 plus negative 3? Negative 12. Do the fish hook again. What do you get? Get positive 9. Good job. Negative times a negative is a positive. 16, right? Fish hook it again. Good job. Negative 12. Add those together. Oof. The numbers are getting a little bit big here, but we're not scared. Fish hook this one. It's a positive for sure. 48 divided by 4 is? 48 divided by 4 is? 12, and then 12 hooked up around times 3 is, in fact, yes, 36. And as expected, there's our zero. So we're now faced with four white numbers that, what do you notice about them? They have an awesome GCF of 4. So let's just get all the dang 4s out of there now, make our lives a little easier. So this is actually going to be 1x to the third, and then this one will be minus 3x squared. This will be plus 4x, and then this will be minus 12. Set that equal to zero. It's 4. I took 4 out of all these. And again, like I said earlier, if the GCF is just a number, you can quite literally just dispose of it. With a factoring quiz, I needed it to stay. But when we're using factoring for another purpose like this, a number doesn't make any difference. So chuck it. Adios, amigo. Yet again, we're going to be doing some grouping. Huh? So we're going to group this bad boy down. What's the GCF on the left? Leaving behind. Yeah. On the right, plus 4, leaving behind. X minus 3. Yeah. So, I mean, I feel like I can start maybe going a little bit. I can bypass a little bit of the formality of writing out the factors. Like, we know where we're headed with this. Let's just get there. One of the equations is going to say that x squared plus 4 has to equal 0, right? You know that. That's why I'm using colors. Yellow is going to make 0. Subtract 4 from both sides. Are we going to need I? We sure are. What's if x squared equals negative 4, what's x equal? 2i. Yeah, we only say the I first if it goes in front of a radical. If it's a regular number, then we put the I after it. So positive, negative 2i. And then, of course, from the white ones, what do we get? So what does x equal? 3. So I actually already kind of started my list right here. You see, I just already got it there. It's ready to go. I think I need one more to round out my 4. Who was my freebie again? Just like that, done. And I would like to squeeze one more in if I possibly can. So good, good. You guys are doing amazing math here today. This is no longer light work. So good job. You've left the realm of the simple days. So for this one, our function is going to be f of x equals 4x to the third plus 14x squared plus 16x. Plus 15, and the freebie. Does anyone want to guess the freebie? It's negative 5/2. Is there a GCF? Then let's roll. Here we go. So we have 4, 14, 16, 15, upside down division sign, and freebie goes on the outside, negative 5/2, and we begin. Drop it, fish hook. What do we get? Noise. Add them together. 4. Fish hook it again. What do you get? Negative 10. Negative 10 again, right? Add those together. What do you get? 6. Want me to pause here for a second?
Yes.
Okay. I don't have much time, so I can only literally give you like 20 seconds because the clock's telling me that I cannot afford. We okay? Fish hook it again. 6 divided by 2 is 3. 3 times negative 5 is negative 15. And hey, look, what a surprise. Look what we got. A 0. I wanted to make sure that I got to this example because this is not a grouping problem like we've been accustomed to this point. So let's go ahead and pop a GCF out of that green oval. What do we get? A 2, right? So then the equation that we're actually solving is 2x squared plus 2x plus 3. And this is a quadratic formula problem now. So I wanted to make sure we got to this. What's A? A is 2. What's B? C? 3. Okay. So right over here to the quadratic formula we go. X equals the opposite of B. So negative 2 plus or minus the square root of what? 4 minus 4. Blank, blank, all divided by double A, which in this case is 4. What goes in my two blank blanks? Mm-hmm. 2 and 3. This is not going to be one that switches to addition. We're expecting imaginary numbers here. Whenever the back half of your B squared minus 4AC is heavier, then you're going to go negative, right? So what's actually inside the square root is 4 minus 24, because that's just simply 4 times 2 times 3. And what is 4 minus 24? Negative 20. So we now have x equals negative 2 plus or minus the square root of negative 20, all divided by 4. And we're almost there. How do you break down a square root of negative 20? Yeah, so it's going to be, remember like we learned, we just think of the square root of negative 20 as just the square root of 20, which is the square root of 4 and the square root of 5, which is 2 root 5. But in reality, since it's negative, it's going to be 2i root 5. So we're going to put this back in here and have negative 2 plus or minus 2i root 5 all over 4. And of course, the Dorito comes into play. What can you divide all those Dorito numbers by? 2, leaving us with a final answer of x equals negative 1 plus or minus I root 5 over 2. And I believe we had one freebie in this problem. Who was it? X equals negative 5/2. And did we get all of our answers out? We did. Woo-wee! Talk about cutting it close. I kind of knew that was going to be a long one. I'll leave that there for a minute.
Wait, it's Shyla Wilson.
Tomorrow's a work day. Do you want me to leave the assignment up or take it down? Are you going to work on it if I leave it up? Okay, I'll take it down. Well, actually, I'll just leave it up. Whatever. What does it matter?